to call the public hearing to order tonight, and I want to thank you all for coming. Before we get into the public hearing, I'd like to introduce the members of council and staff to those in attendance. Starting on my right, your left, at our staff table, we have Mr. Darren Light, our Director of Corporate Services, Carolyn Machada, our Manager of Legislative Services, Mr. Francis Chung, our Chief Administrative Officer. At the council table, Councillor Arnold and Councillor Wallace are not able to be here this evening. Councillor Ted Schaefer, I'm Mayor Peter Fassbender. On my left, your right, Councillor Gail Martin, Councillor Terry James, Councillor Dave Hall. At our other staff table, we have Mr. Gary Vlieg, our Director of Engineering, Parks and the Environment. Mr. Gerald Minchuk, our Director of Development Services and Economic Development, is sitting at the table. And then we have Kim Hilton, our Director of Recreation, Culture, and Community Services. And our Fire Chief, Mr. Rory Thompson, is not here this evening. He had a meeting to go to over at the township with respect to the fire that we had in the city. So I want to welcome all of you. And the purpose of this public hearing tonight will be to provide opportunity for the public to make representation to council and all the persons present who believe that their properties may be affected by the public hearings tonight will be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard or to present written submissions to members of council. Those of you who wish to speak, I would ask that you come up to the microphone, identify yourself by name and address, and then you will give us the benefit of your submission. I would ask that you keep it as brief as possible so that we can have the benefit of those comments. Members of council may, if they wish, ask you questions of clarification following your presentation. However, the main function of council members is not to debate the relative merits of either of the two bylaws. That will be done later in the council meeting. But they will be able to ask you questions of clarification if they have them. Everyone will be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard at this meeting, and no person should feel that they're being restricted in any way from giving their points of view. If you want to present a written submission, I'd ask that you give it to our Manager of Legislative Services, and that will be provided to Council after this evening. So the first bylaw that we are going to be dealing with at this public hearing is Zoning Bylaw 1996, number 2100, Amendment number 119, 2013, and Bylaw number 2907. And this bylaw is with respect, which prohibits the growing of marijuana and related activities except as permitted under the Federal Marijuana Medical Access Regulations. And those regulations are proposed to be repealed and replaced by the Marijuana for Medical Purposes Regulations, and that is under the purview and the responsibility of the federal government. So I'm going to ask Mr. Minchuk to give us the benefit of a presentation, and then I will ask for members of the public, except I'm going to ask our Manager of Legislative Services to let us know how this particular public hearing was advertised and if we have any written correspondence. Please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The notices were placed on the City Hall notice board on Tuesday, April 9th, and advertisements were placed in the April 16th and 18th issues of the Langley Advance. In addition, 200 notices were mailed and hand-delivered regarding Bylaw 2909 to the owners and occupiers of all parcels of land within a 100-meter radius of the subject property. In addition, one piece of correspondence has been received regarding Bylaw 2909, which you should all have a copy of, stating concerns regarding the safety and speed of traffic in the parking lots. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now, Mr. Minchuk, I'll turn it over to you.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The purpose of Zoning Amendment Bylaw number 2907 is as follows. Currently, the zoning bylaw prohibits the use of any premises for selling, distributing, trading, cultivating, growing, or producing of cannabis, marijuana, except as permitted and authorized under the Marijuana Medical Access Regulations under the Controlled Drugs and Substance Act of Canada. The proposed bylaw for council's consideration this evening continues the general prohibition of this use, but with no exceptions, thereby prohibiting the commercial scale medical marijuana production within the city of Langley. Therefore, the wording of the zoning bylaw will be consistent with federal regulations. Furthermore, in the event that we receive a rezoning application to accommodate any use, including the use under consideration this evening, not permitted in the zoning bylaw, our approach will be to consider amending the zoning bylaw and consider a CD comprehensive development zone application to accommodate the proposed use. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Minchuk. I will now open it for any members of the public who wish to make their views known to City Council. I don't see anyone jumping up. Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Minchuk, and we'll go into the next public hearing. And I won't bother reading the same opening statement. It still applies to this as well. And was there any correspondence other than the one piece that was the only one to this one, correct? Thank you. Good evening, and if you could give us the benefit of your name and what you represent, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is Brenda, and I'm the franchisee with CIFA Early Education. I'm here and applying for rezoning at 2510 Langley Bypass to accommodate a child care center. With me tonight, I have my team. So I have Colin Murray from BUK Investments. He's the Vice President of Leasing, and BUK is the landlord at this particular property. Next to him, we have Michael Anderson. He is the President at the Northern Vision Realty, and we also have Susan Gaspar. She's the Franchise Director at CIFA Education System, and we have also with us Robert Chung. He is a professional engineer at Traffic at the Creative Transportation Solutions. So tonight I'm going to do a presentation, and there will be three parts to this presentation. First of all, we'll talk about what CIFA is, how our education method is different from a general daycare. Secondly, we will talk about other governing bodies that has that actually regulates the opening and the operation of our proposed facility. And lastly, we'll talk about the clientele that we have in the city of Langley and how our facility will actually benefit the city of Langley. So first of all, CIFA was originated in 1996 by founder Natasha Biam. In 1998, it was the first facility opened its doors in Park Royal, West Vancouver. The facility's very unique concept was accepted and greatly sought after by the West Vancouver community. So in 2002, a franchise model was put in place, and the founder incorporated the franchise company CIFA Education Systems in 2004. Currently, CIFA operates 9 franchise locations throughout the Lower Mainland, 3 corporate locations, and 1 franchise location in Calgary, Alberta. CIFA is Canada's only accredited junior kindergarten facility. It delivers the finest start in education, art, and humanities. Teachers at CIFA, they are trained early childhood educators, and they're additionally trained and certified by CIFA systems to become specialized junior kindergarten teachers. The program includes children in writing, reading, math, science, music, physical education, visual and dramatic arts, yoga and relaxation, cultural immersion, and more. CIFA is divided into 4 developmental stages. This is very unique in the industry. So we have CIFA Baby for 1 to 2 year olds, Junior Kindergarten 1 for 2 to 3 year olds, Junior Kindergarten 2 for 3 to 4 year olds, and Junior Kindergarten 3 for 4 to 5 year olds. The 4-year program gives each child the opportunity to share learning experiences and play with other children of their same age and intellectual level. So this key difference is reflected on the floor plan of the facility. As you can see, on the right-hand side, the proposed site is going to have 8 classrooms, 2 classrooms for SIVA Baby, 2 for JK1, 2 JK2, and 2 JK3s. Hours of operation, we are open Monday to Friday only, so we are not opened on weekends or stat holidays. The hours are from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. We also have mandatory drop-off and pick-up times, which are 7 to 9 a.m. for drop-off and 4 to 6 p.m. for pick-up. The maximum permitted enrollment at this location will likely be 112 children. The daily numbers, however, are going to be lower because not all children will be full-time. So based on the estimates that we have out of the 13 locations currently in operation, we estimate 75% will be full-time full-day and 25% will be part-time full-day. All students will be enrolled as full-day. We don't have any part-day exceptions. The SIVA education method is an inspiring way and fun way to create lifelong love for learning. It is designed to stimulate the children during the brain's most formative years, increasing the child's intellectual capacity for life. There's also time during the day to play, to make friends, to discover the ever-changing classroom, to go to the park on field trips, to have a relaxation session or even a nap, or watch a movie in our cinema at the end of the day. Our mission at SIVA is to inspire children to learn and be knowledgeable, to seek self-betterment, and to contribute as individuals. So this brings us to the second part of the presentation. I'm going to introduce you to two governing bodies which are also at work at the same time to regulate the opening and operation of our facility. First of all, it's the Fraser Health Authority. We are under a licensing for Community Cares Facility Group Child Care. It is governed by the Community Care and Assisted Living Act of BC. Extremely stringent requirements must be met to be granted a group child care license. Licensing officer at Fraser Health Authority, they thoroughly evaluate every application through extensive documentation and site inspections. So what I have here on the right-hand side is just some of the documentations we submitted to Fraser Health in order for our application to be looked at. And on this slide on the right-hand side here is a snapshot of just the first page of all the regulations under the Community Care and Assisted Living Act for child care. So they regulate on many different aspects, for example, facility requirements, on physical requirements, furniture, fixtures, play area, materials, on employee requirements, character, their skills, criminal record checks, health, emergency training, and first aid. They also regulate employee qualifications, like early childhood certificates, special needs, assistance certificates, and others. On supervision of children, they regulate the group sizes, ratios, active and absent employee records. And on our operations, they regulate our operation hours, program of activities, health hygiene, transportation, water nutrition, etc. On the guidance and treatment of children, on illnesses, and on records. So all of these are under Fraser Health's jurisdiction. Now, I'm just going to go over one specific example on the facility requirements for outdoor playground. So these pictures are taken from other SIVA locations, the top one at North Vancouver SIVA Park Royal, and then the bottom two from Abbotsford. As you can see here, we have concrete barriers and fencing built on top. That is required by Fraser and required and suggested by Fraser Authority because the concrete barriers prevent cars from driving into the children's playground, and the fencing provides security to avoid trespassers entering the playground. They also regulate the fencing material so that they are strong enough to add security but not tall enough for children to climb up and then to fall over. All right, now here is the second governing body that is at work, and this governing body is MOTI, Ministry of Transportation and Infrastructure. So because the proposed site is on Langley Bypass, so we have to get approval from MOTI in order to move forward with the project. What we did was we commissioned Creative Transportation Solutions to conduct a traffic impact study on April 9, 2013. So what I have here is the report from CTS, and without going over the whole report, I will just briefly run over the basic objectives and then the conclusion. So the objectives of this assessment was to conduct a site visit to assess the existing operations, to forecast the estimated volume of traffic for the proposed SIVA site on Langley Bypass, And number three, to conduct intersection capacity analysis of the driveway intersection at Langley Bypass. And lastly, to document and the analysis in a report that meets the requirements of both the Ministry of Transportation and Infrastructure and the City of Langley. So the conclusion after doing this traffic impact study is, so CTS conducted traffic counts, and they also went to three other CIFA sites to survey and gather local traffic generation characteristics for each site. So they said the proposed CIFA site is estimated to be generating a total of 102 vehicle trips during the weekday morning in peak hour and 100 vehicle trips during the afternoon in peak hour. So a peak volume of 102 vehicle trips is equivalent to an average traffic demand of only 1.7 vehicles every minute. Now, because of the fact that this 1.7 vehicles per minute is spread over 2 hours, unlike other schools, so the conclusion is that the traffic generation for this site is not considered significant from a traffic engineering point of view. They went ahead and also did an intersection capacity analysis. And this analysis is a measure of driver's discomfort, frustration, fuel consumption, and lost travel time, and is defined in terms of delay. So after doing the analysis, they've concluded that right now, the overall level of service is rating of A, which means it's excellent. And by having a proposed CIFA facility there, that there will be no reduction in the overall level of service, and it will remain at the level of A, which is excellent. Okay, this brings us to the last part of the presentation, in which we're going to talk about our target clientele. The first group of clients would be commuting parents. And we have something called joint venture partners with Kwantlen Polytechnic University at B, Fraser Health and City Offices at C, and D is Trinity Western University. So what are joint venture programs? What we do is we go into these organizations and we give priority to the people who are working at these organizations to enroll their children at our CIFA facility. Commuting parents. Many working parents actually prefer to keep their children close to their workplace during the day. This location on Langley Bypass is exceptionally convenient for them to drop off or to pick up their children to and from their way to work. Currently, joint venture programs with Kwantlen Polytechnic University and Fraser Health offices have already been set up and running in other communities. There are other big parent supporters, including hospitals and government employees. Now, the number of applications and inquiries by parents who work in and around Langley have actually exceeded our availability at CIFA's North Langley location. So by opening a CIFA on Langley Bypass and providing the much-needed quality child care, we align with the City of Langley's goal of being the place to be. The second group of target clients would be local residents. And according to 2011 census data, the population in the city and township of Langley has grown 11.2% and 6.3% respectively. In the township, the number of toddlers under 5 years old increased by 14.2% from the level 5 years earlier. This is the highest increase since 1981 census. And you can see on the graph on the right-hand side, the green bar represents the population growth in the township of Langley compared to Metro Vancouver, BC, and Canada. The construction of new townhomes also attract many more new and young families into surrounding areas. And we really believe that our facility will align with the city's policy and commitment. First of all, the City of Langley enjoys an active and growing commercial service and industrial sector. The city has an open for business policy and is committed to attract new businesses. Our CIFA's goal is to continuously build and strengthen our business through joint venture partnerships with this new facility. So this reinforces the city's policy and commitment because the facility will meet the needs of parents who work and commute within the region. Secondly, our facility will also employ many teachers and educators. Many of the staff will live in or around the community, contributing greatly to the economy of the city. And lastly, childcare facilities are natural community hubs. Parents are encouraged to participate and be involved in childcare, community, and their children's education. So the result? It draws CIFA, the parents, and the children into the larger community of Langley. So on this last slide, what I have here is on the left-hand side is the proposed site floor plan, and on the right-hand side, our outdoor playground proposed concept. So I hope you can see here that this proposed site is going to be a state-of-the-art facility, providing the much-needed top-quality early childhood education to the city of Langley. We are thoroughly excited to create this facility in the city of Langley, and we thank you in advance for your support. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any members of the public who wish to either ask a question of clarification or have a comment they would like to make? Again, I don't see anyone. Thank you very much for your presentation. We'll be dealing with this in the regular council meeting. I need a motion to close the public hearings. Did you want to ask a question, Councillor Martin? Yes, please go ahead.
Thank you. I was just wondering what the surface of your part of your play area is going to be.
What the surface of the play area is going to be?
Sue, do you want to address that?
I'll ask Sue to address that.
Make sure the switch is up on the microphone. It is. Thank you.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Okay. Susan Gaspar, Franchise Director at CFET. Our facilities often have rubberized tiles for the playground surface, so children climbing up the climbers, if they fall or they trip, they won't hurt themselves. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, I was going to wait till the sirens go by. Your comment was that you often have rubberized...
Yeah, most of them have rubberized tiles.
So what is yours going to be?
It would be the same, either that or engineered wood chips, but it's a soft playground setting that you would find in most child care facilities or playgrounds, park playgrounds underneath the equipment or at other elementary schools.
Because it's all just blacktop there now, right?
Yes. Yeah, so it'll go on top of that, obviously. Yeah.
Thank you. Seeing none others, a motion to go to close the public hearing, moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor James. All of those in favor, it is carried. And we will now move into the regular agenda for this evening. And the first item is I need a motion to approve the minutes from April the 8th, 2013. Councillor Schaefer, seconded by Councillor Martin. Any errors or omissions? Seeing none, all of those in favor, it is carried. Moving into our first delegation this evening, I'd like to ask Lauren Roberts from the Aldergrove Neighbourhood Services Youth Homelessness Society to come up to the microphone. And when you're sitting there, if you can work close to the mic, that would be great.
Try my best.
Welcome.
Good evening, and thank you for having me. Mayor Fassbender has already asked me to excuse him for a nap, so he joined us on a youth homelessness awareness walk on Friday from 11 p.m. to 1 a.m., which was greatly appreciated, so you can close your eyes now.
No, you better work closer to the mic, though.
Okay.
Thanks.
So basically what I'm here to talk about is that city actually approved us for up to $5,000 worth of funding for cold weather response. And so with that, I'm going to take the opportunity to do a little bit of background in regards to youth homelessness, what it looks like, and specifically what we're working towards within the Langley communities. So just a quick snapshot of youth homelessness in Canada. Right now in the greater Vancouver area, obviously Vancouver is the heart of youth homelessness when you think of the picturesque youth homelessness situation, which is often the street homeless. So right now in BC annually, you're looking at close to 15,000 runaways is what they call it. Within BC annually, about 37% of those are in the greater Vancouver area. So in March 15th, 2011, we did a homeless count, and it was the first time within the Langley communities that we did a youth homeless count. Langley at that time had a total of 22 homeless youth, six of which were were sheltered, and 16 were unsheltered. What that means is that the previous night, within 24 hours, they had no place to sleep. Often what ends up happening with that is that when we do the counts in March, they might represent as having no place to sleep when really they were couch surfing or at a friend's house. The big thing with youth homelessness is that it's hidden. It's not like your regular street homeless where you see them walking on the street with buggies and carts. Youth are often staying with families. They're staying with friends, things like that. A lot of sympathetic parents out there are usually the ones who take in the youth. And if you think about it, a lot of the time that also impacts those parents. Some short-term financial support is needed, emotional support for those parents. And then sometimes it's just describing the process. Parents who take in these youth often think they're doing kind of some short-term assistance, when in reality, sometimes it can last up to 3 months, 6 months, and even longer. So describing the process to them is one of the most important things. One of the most difficult issues with determining the needs and the numbers is the fact that they don't self-report or consider themselves to be homeless. If they have a roof over their head, or if they've been able to stay at a place for a period of time, that's when they start thinking of themselves as housed. The word homeless is also kind of a faux pas for youth. A lot of youth, when they think of homeless, they're giving up. Youth are in fact quite resilient when it comes to youth homelessness. They're quite able to find other places to live, places to stay, and unless they're in crisis, they often won't come to ask for help. So one of the things is that when you talk about a profile for a homeless youth, a youth could be walking down the street and nobody would have any idea, not even myself, not somebody who's been working with youth for a long period of time, whether they'd be homeless just visually or not. And so one of the things is that's really important is building relationships with these youth. You have to know who they are, you have to know where they're coming from, and that's where other professionals are really helpful in those situations. Our number one referral source right now is often the schools and teachers, because they're the ones that see these youth every day and can recognize when things are going sideways for them. So it talks about some of the things for them. They're more susceptible to illness. Homeless youth actually have a death rate of more than 10% of the regular population. And a lot of it really comes down to poor physical health. In Langley, we're quite happy, actually, and quite lucky to have Fraser Health do a youth wellness clinic. That provides direct access for the youth. It makes it really easy. It's one of the strong partnerships that we built within our community on behalf of our agency. And so if we have a homeless youth who needs to go in, they actually have no wait times due to the label that they might carry when they walk in there. So again, how do we immediately try and identify youth? The highest indicator is the lack of contact with parents, or when they're discussing what is going on, you can tell by poor hygiene. Often youth who are couch surfing from place to place have a lot of their bags and a lot of their personal belongings in different locations. And so if you ask them a question about where's the some place that we can get your clothes, they might actually locate or talk about specific locations up to 2-3 different places to go and pick them up. So why are they homeless? A variety of different reasons. Some of those are the family conflict is probably the number one that we see. Probably the biggest impact for us over the past 4 years has been social media. As a parent, it's much easier to keep a tabs on your youth if you have social media. So if you're able to text your youth or find your iPad, find your iPhone, those types of things, it's easier to find out where exactly your youth are and when they're doing things that they're not supposed to. So other things are the exposure to violence and or abuse within the home. A lot of these indications we're actually able to go to MCFD with, or the Ministry of Child and Family Development. In some cases, they're outside of that scope, so those are often the youth that we're doing what we call housing loss prevention with. So again, youth have a death rate that's more than 10 times the current rate of the general population. The number one thing on this slide that I want to point out is the fact that youth who couch surf have a victimization rate of more than 60% higher than the regular youth population. The biggest thing with that is that that's often because they're going to unsafe situations or situations where there's a lot of drug use. There's often they're staying with people who are older than themselves or strangers in order just to get a place to stay. And I think that what ends up happening is that there's physical abuse, sexual abuse, those types of things that often happen in return for that housing. So one of the things for the costs for society, often youth who are homeless, if they're homeless for a long period of time, and long period of time is 3 months or more, they start turning to the street lifestyle, which then turns into detention. So that's why this stat is up here. It's easily defined, but estimates are between $30,000 to $40,000 a year to house these youth within a shelter system, which includes transitional housing. Keeping just one youth in detention for a full year is about $250 a day or $100,000 a year. And so not only prevention-wise, but also to support the youth, it makes a lot of sense to look at transition housing and emergency shelter for youth. So some of the barriers that we often face when we're working with these youth is that they feel like outsiders due to a lack of confidence. They feel like they've been given up on. There's often attachment issues, those types of things. So they feel like they don't have any skills when really they have quite a number of skills. And often we're the ones who are trying to point them out. Survival skills is a huge piece when we talk about resiliency. A lot of youth who come to us are in a point of crisis. Often youth have couch surfed, I would say on average, between 2 to 3 months before they show up at our door. These are youth who have found other places to stay, who have actually went out and somehow found like shelter for a short period of time. They'd be able to tell you where all the free meals are in town. They'd also be able to tell you where you can get cheap meals, like the $2 fast food meals and those types of things. So living on the street involves more than finding a place to sleep. A lot of that lifestyle has to do with the selling of drugs, selling of personal belongings, selling of self. And so for us, one of the big things that we talk to the youth is that it's important to understand that leaving that lifestyle behind can be difficult. We work very closely with the RCMP when we become attached to a youth who's we're transitioning into independence, and we believe that there's some issues there. The RCMP are actually willing to sit down with them as well and have a discussion. And then beyond affordability, it's equally as difficult for youth to find a suitable living space. So often one of the big things on this is transportation. I know that Langley talks a lot about transportation. In order to find a youth an adequate place to stay that's not only safe but comfortable, it's very difficult within the Langley communities to get that and have it close to transportation. So a lot of the time we're looking at illegal suites, those types of things for youth. Youth under the age of 19, a lot of landlords and tenants are actually a little bit tenants, or they have a tendency not to bring in those youth due to the fact that they're underage. And they don't feel like they want them to legally sign tenancy agreements. I would be willing to say that if a youth was to show up at my door and ask me for a tenancy agreement for 1 year, I would have a little bit of tendency not to do that as well. So it's understandable. We do what we call a friendly landlord program where we talk with the landlords, we try and work with them, and keep the youth housed for a longer period of time. So the three solutions to homelessness are adequate affordable housing, needing enough money to live comfortably, and that they're at risk, so they need a lot of support services. Within the Langley communities, there's a lot of great organizations out here that work very closely with these youth and are willing to go over and above to try and support us as we move forward with these youth as well. So basically what our vision is to try and create programming that's easily accessible and youth-friendly to support our youth in becoming financially and socially independent. We do that by a few things. One is through our drop-in center up in Aldergrove. It's the first contact site out there. We're always willing to say that visually it's not the greatest place because of the fact that a lot of the youth that we're working with can be difficult at times, but it's a place for these youth to go. It keeps them out of trouble for that period of time as well. It allows us to provide some services. The other piece is our starting point office, and this is right in Langley City. This is in partnership with Stepping Stone Community Services. Basically, this provides anybody or the homeless population of all ages a one-stop shop to go to get some sort of housing supports. A lot of the youth that we work with right now, we're working with a caseload between 20 and 30 youth. Not all of those youth are homeless. Some we're doing what we call housing loss prevention with, which means that we're talking with family, we're getting them involved with family mediation. We're doing the best that we can in that period of time. Sometimes it's short-term financial support and those types of things. But basically, we try and do as much as we can within that office. Since June 10th, when we did our grand opening of 2012, we've seen 79 youth through our doors. 55 of those are under the age of 19. With that being said, not every single one of those youth was what we would consider to be homeless. Some of those youth were looking for employment resources, and we just happened to be the place that they stumbled into, and then what we do is we refer on to other resources. But the majority of those youth are somehow at risk of becoming homeless. And that's all.
Thank you very much. Any questions or comments from members of council? I just wanted to add, having had a chance with Councillor Wallace to visit LSS and talking with the principal, I know that they're working very closely with you, not only in that high school, but Brookswood and Aldergrove Secondary and the other high schools as well. So appreciate the efforts, appreciate your bringing that awareness, and I know as you start to develop plans that those will be made more public and more engagement, so we look forward to hearing more from you at that point. And
sounds good. I forgot to report on the money that you came
Yes, with. Please.
So basically what we were able to provide for the first year was within Langley, the emergency weather response that currently goes out of the Gateway of Hope, unfortunately, doesn't serve all populations. So we saw a large gap over the past couple of years, and with the funding that we were able that you were able to provide us, actually gave us an opportunity to launch a program that we called the Youth Weather Response. One of the things was that there was a lot of development and partnerships and places like that. The great thing was that for the first time ever in Langley, we were able to do a youth-specific youth weather response, which was great. We didn't see any youth, which you could also look at being a great thing due to the fact that it's like an insurance policy. You buy it in the hopes that you don't have to use it. The big thing for us was that we realized that one of the things we did wrong at the start was that we didn't have the right community awareness. When we had first piloted the project, we talked with some of the youth that we worked with and those types of things and tried to get some sort of awareness out. The second step that we did was we took it to schools and put posters up in schools. And then we started to realize that it really is the face-to-face contact that makes the difference. So what it became is it's really become seed money for us to go forward with this project. We've developed it. It could be passed on to anybody now within the community who's willing to take it on or ourselves for this next year. And so with that, I'm willing to say that I'm very confident with the fact that we'd be able to run a full season of a youth weather response this year.
Great. Thank you very much. I don't see any questions, so thank you very much. And I'd now like to ask Henry Grayman from the Ministry of Children and Family Development to come up and just sort of speak a little bit about the same issue. Welcome, Henry.
Thank you. So as Peter indicated, I'm from the Ministry of Children and Family Development. I'm the community service manager with them. And I have to close out of here. Where do you do that? Escape. Great. Thank you very much, Kim. So one of the things that that I was asked by the Township Council and also by Mayor Fassbender, what does MCFD provide? What does the province provide for kids who are youth in particular who are at risk and perhaps homeless? And particularly high-risk youth. So I thought I'd quickly go through the PowerPoint here. And okay, first of all, you should be aware there is no federal government homelessness reduction strategy. And Canada is the only G8 country without a homelessness reduction strategy. Okay, so that's an important piece of information, and I'll show you why. Homelessness, particularly youth homelessness, must be solved in an ad hoc manner as a result. So it involves provincial, municipal governments, as well as community involvement. To be fair to the federal folks, by times there are federal funds available to augment local initiatives. However, they are on an ad hoc basis. The next slide is just a continuum to give you an idea for at-risk youth to a youth who's stable. As to the various types of programming that might be available for them. So on the one end, on my left side, start with homelessness, and as Lauren mentioned, couch surfing, they might be staying with friends. Then there's the emergency response, so a hospital, so if they're ill. There's the cold, wet weather initiative that Lauren spoke about a little bit, and youth shelters. Now, youth shelters, you'll find out, are in other communities. They don't exist in Langley. Next, moving along on the continuum, there's treatment programming for alcohol and drug abuse. It could be long-term, short-term programming, and mental health, psychiatric help as well. Again, that's in an institution. There's transitional housing that we provide, when I say we, this MCFD, for youth justice clients, and I'll speak a little bit more about that in the next slide. MCFD, if we move along a little further on this continuum, there are group homes and there are foster homes as well. And again, that's for youth who have been abused or neglected, and they would come into care. For those youth who are already in care and who are 16 and older, 16 to 19 years of age, we look at developing independent living for them, the skills so that they can move on, because at age 19 they are no longer in care of MCFD and they are, from our vantage point, considered an adult and they are independent. So we have to develop those life skills, independent living skills. There's a mentorship program to help them establish some of those skills. By times we also have youth agreements, so youth come to us, again 16 to 19 years of age, and again they're abused, they're neglected in some fashion, and we can put them on a youth agreement. So rather than taking them into care, we put them on this type of agreement and they can go into housing with some supports available to them. There's also goals that are set with the social worker that we want them to meet, such as going to school or looking for a job or training, this sort of thing. And there is some community help to find suitable housing. And then, of course, the last line in this is the goal that we have for all young people, which is stable family supports, stable living conditions, and stable employment. So that's the ultimate goal. We're going through these, and there's the goal. So just to go through some of the programs that are available through the ministry, there's child and youth mental health programs, and that's our ministry. Addiction and substance misuse, that's through the Ministry of Health, which funds that type of programming through Fraser Health Authority. Youth agreements, which I spoke of earlier on. And then there is underage social assistance for youth 16 years and older through the Ministry of Social Development. The catch there is the parents have to sign a document that says the youth is not able to come back home. And as mentioned earlier, youth can be taken into care if they're abused or neglected. And there's the transition housing for youth who have gone to court, been found guilty of a crime under the youth criminal justice system, and their parents have said, no, Johnny is not coming home, he's not welcome, so Johnny needs a place to stay. We have a transition bed available for him to stay for at least 30 days until we find some proper housing for Johnny. The next slide, I'd just like to show you about the particular centers that shelters that are available close to Langley. And there are three in three communities. So there's Cyrus Center in Abbotsford. It supplies emergency food and shelter for 10 beds. It's funded by local churches and the municipality, and MCFD, our ministry, has bought two of those 10 beds. The next closest shelter is in Maple Ridge. It's called Iron Horse. It has 5 beds. It's funded by federal youth homelessness monies. And the District of Maple Ridge provides a 5-bedroom house rent-free. The next closest is in Surrey, and it's called the All Nations Safe House. It's primarily for Aboriginal youth. However, other youth are also welcome. And it's 6 beds, and this is solely funded by our Ministry of Children and Family Development. The next slide provides for you just a list of some of the other shelters available to youth in the Vancouver area and North Vancouver, and some of the funding, where the funding comes from. Some of it is from MCFD, others is municipal authorities, and a bit of it is also from the feds through the HPS. And then Covenant House is BC Housing and fundraising. So in 2011 there was a homeless count. My figure is 15. Actually, Lorne's is probably a little more up to date. He mentions 22. I hadn't counted in the youth that, frankly, were already placed in shelters in Abbotsford, Surrey, and over in other facilities in other communities as well. So one of the things that the Langley Child and Youth Committee has put on their agenda as part of their strategy, one of their goals is to develop some housing for youth that fit this category. So at-risk youth who may be homeless or at risk of homelessness. And so it's part of our strategic plan. That's one of the goals. And then our particular strategies for that, Lauren has identified the cold wet weather strategy. The city of Langley and the township have put some money towards that. And that also helps to coordinate the various organizations that may be involved with those youth, so to provide, to find housing for them. So, and that's an initiative that's strictly funded by yourselves and volunteers. The second strategy is to develop transitional housing with three beds. Two beds would be available helping youth to independence, so they're longer term type of beds, 6 months to a year, in order to get them on their feet, provide them with the skills that they need to become independent. And the third bed would be type of a swing bed, which would house as an emergency shelter youth who needed a bed to stay in tonight. Now, this particular initiative, though, would involve federal, provincial, municipal, and community support. So it needs all three levels of government plus the community support in order to make it work. And that's my presentation for tonight. I'm certainly open to questions if council has any.
Thank you, Henry. Comments? Councillor Martin.
Thank you. The youth facilities that were in and around Langley you showed, and there's the one, the All Nations Youth Housing in Surrey. Why is that the only one that MCFD funds?
Well, it's primarily for Aboriginal youth, and so the funding came through the federal government and to the province for Aboriginal youth, the Aboriginal children, and so that's how that money came to MCFD, and MCFD could put it towards that shelter. You'll notice also in that slide, in the following slide, there was the ASH program in Vancouver, which is also an Aboriginal shelter, and also funded by MCFD, comes through the same funding stream.
I guess that's kind of sad that the federal government thinks that housing for Aboriginals is more important than just, you know, regular Canadian youth or, you know, white youth. It's sad that has to happen in our day and age. I mean, I you know, all youth that are homeless should be looked after. So I don't know why they do just for the Aboriginals. Are these shelters open 24/7?
Well, not necessarily. Some of the shelters close at 9 o'clock in the morning. They're wanting the youth to go to school or to be in some educational program, or in some work type of program, or learning a trade, or getting some help through counseling, through perhaps if there's an addiction problem. And then they open up in the evening. So that's some of the shelters. Other shelters are there open during the day because they in fact have some counseling program attached to them, and then they can funnel the youth to that counseling program and help him or her.
That was actually going to be my next question in regards to the shelters that, you know, you said food and shelter is available, so some of them do have counseling. So further to that, you're looking at, or the committee's looking at, a permanent shelter or for transitional housing for youth. could I assume in order for the youth to get in that, they'd have to make a commitment to go to counseling or to get a job or stay off drugs or alcohol or whatever before that they get a permanent bed in that place?
Well, for emergency housing, we want to be clear that you want as low a barrier as you possibly can.
I understand the emergency, but I thought you wanted some transitional housing.
Transitional housing, absolutely. For transitional housing, to be clear, there is a commitment then on the part of the youth to seek some counseling if they need counseling, if there's work that needs to happen with their parents or their family. School is possibly on the horizon with them as well. Could be a trade that we would like them to get involved with. Could be a treatment center. They need some treatment as well. So all of those things are on the table to help this youth become stable and move on to stable housing.
Now, you said that all local, municipal, provincial, and federal government have to be involved, as well as community support. Do you have a dollar figure on any of this?
I don't. That's a good question, and I would have to get back to you on a dollar figure. What some municipalities have done is they've found a building that could house, and they've youth, and they've provided that rent-free to this type of arrangement. And one of the things that I'm thinking about, and that the CYC or the Child and Youth Committee will consider, is that in the federal budget, the recent federal budget, there's a piece in there that they talk about. They would like to have housing for youth, and they're talking about homeless, at-risk type of youth, which got me really quite excited, because I was thinking that in the past the feds have given money to renovate buildings, and I'm thinking that this might be an opportunity for us in Langley if we had a building available. And there was seen as a collaborative effort with the municipalities. The federal government could kick in some money to renovate the building, and then ongoing costs would be partitioned between ourselves, MCFD, and other folks as well. So that's the sort of collaborative type of effort that I'm looking at to try to establish here in Langley.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other questions, Councillor Hall?
The original presentation suggested that only 40 youth were identified as homeless in Surrey, a much larger population than here. And I'm looking at your presentation and seeing that there's not much of a provision. So I'm wondering who's fallen through the cracks at this point. So maybe you could enlighten me a little bit. Many adults that are homeless, I won't say many, a percentage of them are homeless by choice through mental issues and other disabilities and things. So do we have a similar percentage of youth who cannot live by the guidelines of their own home? They can't accept the guidelines of a group home, and similarly can't accept the guidelines of a transitional shelter environment?
Well, it's a really good question, actually, and you're absolutely right. There are youth like that, and frankly, some of them are on the caseloads of the youth workers that we have with MCFD. They are our highest risk youth, and I emphasize that because those are the youth that we worry about their mortality, frankly. So what's the nature of these youth? Many of them are addicted. They have been massively abused or neglected, and so they have mental health problems as well. Many of them also sell their bodies to pay for their addictions and pay for some crack house that shelters them, and I wouldn't even call it a shelter. So we worry about those youth a lot. We work very hard with those youth because building trust, I think Lauren talked about that earlier, is very, very important. You want to engage them, build trust, because they've been massively abused, they've been massively done in by adults. So for an adult, for them to trust an adult is very difficult. So we work, and we have workers, of course, who are very skilled at engaging youth and working with them so that they don't end up dead, and that we can, in fact, eventually put them in programs. We can either put them in programs that we have or other programs that the community offers. It takes a lot of work, though. So you're absolutely right. There are youth who do fall in those cracks, but we try very hard to work with them.
Thank you. I see no other comments. I want to thank both you and Lauren for coming tonight, and I know it's a very complicated issue, but I think one of the things that I've seen around the Healthier Community Partnership table is a willingness for everyone in the community to work together and try and identify what we can do. And funding is always a challenge for everything, for everybody, and we know that, and that's one of the reasons both the township and the city stepped up, at least to set the framework for something that can then engage others to the solution. So, Henry, I want to thank you and Lauren for both being here tonight, and we'll stay engaged as much as we can. I think one of the challenges that municipal governments have is a feeling sometimes that this is where they live on the street, so therefore the pressure comes on us. And I think we need to advocate with the higher levels of government for a national strategy and for more engagement at those levels as well. So thank you both very much for being here tonight and the hard work that you do, because I know it's not easy. So
thank you very much for the opportunity to make this presentation.
Thank you. Now moving to our next delegation, I'd like to ask Mr. Greg Walker from the British Columbia Lottery Corporation to come forward and to make a presentation, I think, along with myself for the Responsible Gaming Awareness Week. So I'm going to come up there and join you, Greg. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor.
Welcome.
Thank you very much. It is my pleasure, Mr. Mayor and members of council, to. My name is Greg Walker. I'm the Director of Public Affairs.
Quite close.
I'm getting closer. And I have the extreme pleasure today to join with your worship to celebrate Responsible Gambling Awareness Week in the city of Langley. First one we've ever done in the city of Langley, and part of an initiative that saw five communities across the province in their first ever Responsible Gambling Awareness Week. We're here to celebrate the City of Langley Recreation, Culture, and Community Services Department, the Langley Community Service Society, and the Langley Senior Resources Society. I have a few remarks, and then we have a video that we want to talk about, and then I'm going to ask your worship to introduce members of those organizations. This was a success because we did collaborate with community organizations, and in my organization I'm kind of the guy who gets out of the building and comes out in the community, and we had a lot of successes because we did that in places like Vernon and Prince George, West Shore and Kamloops, and here in Langley. We had a lot of community partners that joined us. I've named a couple of them. A couple of them also have representatives here in chambers tonight, so if I might, I'd like to introduce Tanya Gabara. If you could just stand. The marketing manager for Cascades. And some of you may recognize, if you were able to get out to the events at Responsible Gambling Awareness Week, Mr. Walt Cron, who is a game sense advisor with BCLC, who works in the casinos and in the communities as well on this initiative. This was a major milestone for us. You might have heard of game sense, or you might have heard of Know Your Limit and Play Within It. But what we did here was we reached out into the community and we put some flesh on those bones. We made people give them an opportunity to understand what our initiatives are about, what voluntary self-exclusion, what problem gambling is, what responsible gambling is, and gave people an opportunity to learn about things like our myth-busting kiosk, which came to places like Quantlin here in Langley. We were at the Save on Foods in Aldergrove. We went to Willowbrook Mall. We reached out in the community, and we got a lot of traction from that. And we're very, very pleased, and I can tell you right now that our board and executive are so pleased that they want us to do it again, which is the first thing that I'm here to talk about, because yes, Kim, we're going to come back in all the communities again next year and do it again. I think we moved a lot of yardsticks. We did some measurement. We found out in our surveys pre and post the event here in Langley and other places just how much people came to understand what responsible gambling was all about. And as I said, we're immensely pleased with that. We know we're going in the right direction. We're going to build on that foundation next year, and we'll be calling upon some of our partners and looking forward to doing that again. We do have a video. We did send a videographer around to give you a short flavor of what that was like in other communities and here in Langley, and then I'm going to call upon your worship.
Thank you.
Of a win, and winning is fun. For most, the enjoyment is in playing the game. But for a small portion of the population, gambling offers a mythical promise. Maybe if I play this slot machine longer, I will get closer to a win. The odds will improve, I'll be a winner. Correcting myths and connecting people to resources was the motivation behind Responsible Gambling Awareness Month.
The messaging is, if you gamble, if you play, we want it to remain fun and entertaining, and we want it to remain safe. We want people to play responsibly.
Responsible gambling awareness events took place in Kamloops, Langley, the west shore of Vancouver Island, Vernon and Prince George, where a wide range of community groups played a role debunking myths about gambling.
Problems aren't increasing, but unless we do some more work in communities to address the issues, we may see those numbers go up. So we want to really take that prevention focus.
It's a message that was echoed on the west shore of Vancouver Island.
If someone is a gambler, maybe on the edge of it becoming an addiction or a problem, maybe this material will help them, or even a family member can see this material and that will help them.
The message in all five communities was the same. Don't chase losses. Take frequent breaks. Know your limit and play within it. Know how gambling works before you play. And if you are someone who needs help, there are resources and services in your community.
This is Responsible Gambling Awareness Week in Kamloops.
It was a real group sort of effort, all sorts of different organizations and groups coming together, pitching in what they could in order to make this as successful as we're certain it's going to be.
We care about this issue. We care about our players, and there's a lot of things we're doing to support our players and make sure that they view gambling as an entertainment option.
For some, it's about helping to reset their perception of gambling. In Langley, youth and gambling was front and center.
What we know is if parents gamble, kids are more likely to gamble. If parents have problems, kids are more likely to have problems. So a lot of it is just dialoguing about what gambling is.
Helping youth and their families keep gambling as a form of entertainment was the focus in Langley during Responsible Gambling Awareness Month. In Vernon, where it debuted in 2012, they did it again.
It was a huge success. You know, we were able to get out into the community, into the seniors' complexes, up at the college. This year we've been at a hockey game. And so it's just really taking that message of responsible gambling, rolling it out into the community, and trying to connect with people just one-on-one.
Responsible Gambling Awareness Month closed with the inaugural New Horizons in Responsible Gambling Conference in Vancouver, and it attracted a lot of attention and international presenters and attendees.
Why is responsible marketing so incredibly important? It's the right thing to do from a moral point of view, but it also is an economic survival imperative.
It's important that we create that community dialogue so that we can help inform people about how to utilize our products responsibly.
Responsible Gambling Awareness Month was a success, reaching thousands of British Columbians with information about the odds of games, how to play responsibly, and where to go for help if needed. social service agencies, local residents, municipal governments, casinos, BCLC, and the province of BC's responsible and problem gambling program came together to ensure that gambling remains a fun and enjoyable form of entertainment for everyone that participates.
And Mr. Mayor, I missed only on one introduction, and that is the person who probably a lot of the folks in this room recognize the most, and that's Nicole Lewis from our Public Affairs Department, who was front and center on responsible gambling. Please.
Thank you, Greg and Nicole and everybody else who's here. And, you know, as I think the video demonstrated, responsible gaming is not a single agency's responsibility. It takes the partnership of all of us who either benefit from gaming or who have social issues around gaming that we grapple with and we talk about and we hear anecdotally. So I really want to thank, first of all, Kim and her department and the other staff in the city of Langley for the effort and the time that they put into this, from the idea being conceived to do it in Langley and then actually seeing it come together. And we also had the Langley Community Services Society, who's represented here tonight, and the Langley Seniors Resource Society, BCLC, as you know, and also Cascades Casino. And I know since we have our casino established in the city, a lot of people have asked questions. You know, has it contributed to more issues in our community? And what we found is that absolutely the norm across the country is still issues that we face in our community and other communities around us. But in terms of corporate contribution and commitment to making a difference, I know that BCLC and Cascades have worked hard to try and do what they can to work with our community in so many different ways. And Kim's telling me to move over because she's the camera person, too, and I'm out of the camera lens. Anyways, thank you. One of the things that I know is both the Langley Times and the Langley Advance were really helpful as we put this event together to give it the publicity. Because like anything, unless you tell people that you're having it, they don't know about it, and they may come on it by chance at a mall or other public facility. But getting the word out that we took it seriously and we had events in our community, I want to thank both the newspapers for being a partner in getting that word out. And we found, and I think Langley has a reputation, good old little city of Langley, that we tend to be a leader in this initiative. We actually had over 630 people from the community, from the surrounding community, who came to the kiosk that existed, and that's the highest in the whole province. So I think the awareness levels and all of the effort that were put in by everybody who participated showed that that effort was worth it, because 630 people, and if you multiply that by their extended families and their network of friends and so on, that message got out, and I think it proved to us that doing something like this has benefits to the entire community, and we supported it. And I think really what it did for me, I know at the launch event most of council was able to be there, it really helped us to raise the level of discussion about issues around gaming and responsible gaming. And I think the key thing is here, and we said it at the launch, it's about prevention. If we can teach young people especially what gaming is all about, what the implications are, then we can educate them and prevent problems from happening. We're not going to prevent all of them, we know that, but the reality is some of them can be prevented with good education and good information. So I really think that it was good for us, and I hope that in 2014 and the years in the future, we continue to do that. And I think that we play a part in bringing what resources we can to educate the public to that and be responsible in what we do. Now, in order to, I kind of recognize the people involved, I'm going to ask Barb Stack first to come forward from the Langley Seniors Resource Society, and I want to recognize their contribution. And I think that, again, it's an organization that recognizes seniors have responsibilities and relationships with gaming, and they wanted to be a part of the solution. So Barb, on behalf of, I think, BCLC, all of the partners, and the City of Langley, I want to thank you. You take this back and know how to know your limit and play within it. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Barb. And then I want to ask Lindsay to come forward for the Langley Community Services Society. Lindsay Follett, who's the manager of external relations, if you want to come over here. I'm not going to move too far. Thank you for your help. I know the team really appreciated what perspective you brought to it as well. I think
Lindsay, congratulations.
All the best. Thank you very much. And I know this lady doesn't do this for awards or plaques, but I want to ask Kim Hilton to come up on behalf of the city and all city staff. And Kim, I know when we first talked about this, you said, oh, great, just another job. Thank you. But I think as you got into it, you saw the passion that we had to make it. And if you want to play with the camera, Greg, while she's open, no, I'm just kidding. Anyways, on behalf of all of us, thank you for the effort, and you make sure you pass this around to everybody at the staff as well. So thank you. And so you know what, folks, it's only the beginning, and a journey of 1,000 miles began with the first step, and this was a first major step. And the fact that Langley led the number of people that visited the kiosk makes us proud as a community that we provided that opportunity. And I want to thank all the partners, Cascades, BCLC, the agencies that have already been mentioned, but most of all the people that came out who said, I'd like to know a little bit more, and I want to be a part of the solution, not part of the problem. So thank you, Greg. Thank you for the presentation, and I appreciate your support as well. Thank you. Let's give Greg a hand, too. Now, our final delegation or presentation tonight is a very special one. And I'm going to ask Mr. Wink Vogel and William Vogel from, they're going to come forward and talk to us about a very special event that's taking place. Gentlemen, come on up.
My name is Wink Vogel, and I'm the chairman of Cloverdale Paint. And Brother Bill is a resident of Langley, and our family have roots in Langley, and the business has roots in Surrey in Langley. And we're very proud to tell you a little bit of the history of the company and the connection to Langley and Langley City. The founder was Rudy Hinke, and he was a German immigrant living on a farm just east of Cloverdale. And he started making paint for his own contracting business in 1933. And he, during World War II, bought a property in what is now the city of Langley, but on the then Trans-Canada Highway, just a mile west of Langley, and hand-built a 3,000-square-foot factory and store. And it was called the Cloverdale Paint Factory. Rudy was entrepreneurial. He made and sold apple cider, eggs, and vegetables in the Surrey market, and paint. Bill and I both had the pleasure of working with Rudy on weekends when we were in high school in Langley. And he was a real gentleman and a man with vision. My father, Hunter Vogel, or our father, sorry, bought a half interest in 1948. Rudy advertised for a business partner. And my father liked what he saw, and he became the president and the CEO, and Rudy became the plant manager and technical man. We've given you each a copy of the book. It's very brief. It's a good, easy read. It's full of stories, short stories, and pictures of staff. Like the next picture. How do I change the...
Somebody will do it for you.
I need a button pusher here.
Oop, wrong button.
This is a picture of Rudy Hinke in 1975, and he is the founder. And the brochure on the right is a 30s brochure that he produced when he was selling paint from his farm on the old McClellan Road. Just an amazing piece of literature, and we're really quite blessed to have it. The next picture is a label of his prime white paint. It was made with white lead, boiled linseed oil, calcium carbonate, dryers, and Bill and I made that paint in a 10-gallon bucket in this Langley building. And he sold all of his paint at a 20% factory to you discount, cash discount. So the $4.50 a gallon price, we wish we had it today, less 20% was the price that Rudy sold his paint for. He advertised on CKNW. Next slide, Bill. This is the building which he and Elmo Hicks built in 1944. And the tower at the end had 45-gallon drums with the tops cut out, and it held solvent, boiled linseed oil, and raw linseed oil. Paint making was between the tower and the second window from the right, and the public would walk in the double doors, and we sold paint from 2x4 shelves. And it was pretty simple, shingle stains and house paint. That was his product. That's a picture of Rudy and my our father, in 1949, and they're demonstrating a handmade piece of machinery that clamped the lids on the gallon can that was produced by a steel shop just in East...
Dunk Anderson
in East Langley.
Anderson Engineering built all the equipment.
Yeah. And the next slide is a picture of Hunter Vogel, our father. He really distinguished himself in Langley. He, when he first came here, we bought a home on New McClellan Road, and he immediately got involved with the Chamber of Commerce, and he succeeded to become the Canadian president of the Chamber of Commerce. He was a lay magistrate in Langley, and when the Langley City incorporated, Hunter was the first provisional mayor. Not elected, but he was the provisional mayor with a provisional council. And then he went on to become an MLA and served under Wacky Bennett, social credit government, for 10 years and retired as a party whip. And he was the member for Langley when he retired. This is a sales graph starting in 1933 in the left and ending at 212. And as you see, with this scale, it looks like we were dead for 30 or 40 years. From a heartbeat point of view, it's pretty flat. But in the book, I broke the years into 25-year periods, so there's a little more growth in the early 25 years, the mid-25 years, which was an extraordinary partnership with the food giant Kelly Douglas and the Weston Corporation. They invested in a new factory in Surrey, which we still occupy today. And our family purchased back the controlling share block from the Weston Corporation and Kelly Douglas in 1975, 76. We had a good piece of growth up to 83. The big recession of 82 almost put us out of business. We almost got put out of business in 61 through an employee embezzlement before we had good bookkeeping. And we survived the 82 recession, convinced the banks to continue to finance us. And since the 80s, we've had extraordinary growth. Cloverdale Paint now operates 110 corporate paint stores. We're predominantly a Western Canadian paint company from Manitoba West with over 65 corporate stores. We do 60% of our total business industrial OEM, heavy-duty coatings, maintenance, and OEM. Architectural is about half of our total business, but we have a subsidiary in the United States called Rada Paint, and it is a former family business that now is a wholly owned subsidiary. Factory and head office in Portland, Oregon, and they operate in Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Montana, and Alaska. And they have 49 corporate stores and a very beautiful factory. It's the largest factory in our group. It's a 9-acre site, not fully developed, but has future potential. Since 2000, we've had a series of acquisitions that has catapulted our growth to become the largest Canadian-owned paint company. And believe me, Bill and I, when we worked with Rudy as high school kids, you just never would have believed it. We were 20th out of 20 entrepreneurial paint companies in British Columbia. How could that happen? It really is an amazing accomplishment. We have 5 paint factories, all acquisitions, a small plant in Calgary that makes board coatings, and we're a major supplier to solder industry that coat boards in plant for sale in Home Depot and Lowe's. We have a beautiful modern industrial factory in Winnipeg, formerly was the Girton Brothers Coatings, and they produce powder, resin, and putty. And we also previously owned a paint company in Winnipeg that we shut the plant down. It was called Northern Paint. And we just last year purchased a small industrial paint company in Ontario. So we now have an industrial branch and factory in Mississauga. And when we bought the Girton plant in 2008, just before the recession, they had 25% of their business in Quebec. And once we realized that that was a good part of their company, we purchased the branch and hired the former owner of the branch that was a customer. And he is still employed and working with Cloverdale. And that branch is just knocking over industrial accounts amazingly in Quebec and Ontario. The book is really aimed at the employees. You'll see a lot of employee pictures. We've been a profit-sharing company since 1977 after the buyback from George Weston, Kelly Douglas. The private ownership of the company is unique. The family ownership, family business is unique. The morale of the company is amazing, and we give a lot of credit to the profit sharing. The individual payment to every employee for 2012 was $7,000, over and above their hourly rates at stores, factories, office, wherever they worked. The last picture is, I was interested to see that you use the slogan, "The Place to Be." Cloverdale Paint picked up the slogan, not knowing we'd stolen it from Langley, so I don't know who did it first. But
well, our lawyers are going to be in touch.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure we'll be sued. But this was the first sales conference that we reinstigated after the recession in Victoria, because we left a healthy deposit there when we canceled our 2009 conference because of the recession. But there's about 180 employees there from across Canada and a few of the executives from Rada Paint in the U.S. And we coined the slogan, "The Place to Be," for the paint industry because we have attracted very fine store staff, store managers, salespeople, management, chemists from other companies, the big bad competitors. I don't have to name them. And now that we're the largest Canadian-owned paint company, we still continue to attract very fine employees, and they like working at our company, and everybody is proud to say, yeah, Cloverdale's the place to be in the paint business. I think that's our last picture. So thank you for the opportunity to present. Our family feels very grateful to the community of Langley. When we were struggling in our high school days to sell paint, our acceptance and recognition was not very high. Our product technology and strength of staff was not very superb, except for the Vogel family. And through the years, we've improved and built a very fine company, and we're very proud to say that our roots are from Langley and Surrey. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. It is a fantastic book. Any comments from members of council? Councillor Schaefer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This brings back some fond memories. Wink and Bill must remember the days of the yearly trip to Kelowna. And I can speak from fondness because my father used it in the 50s and 60s. My dad had 20 acres in Newton. He had the Dairy Queen property by the Surrey Hospital, the rickshaw property on the King George Highway as well, and multitudes of smaller properties all around Surrey Place. So they were, if he had been alive, he would be 108. So they chummed around together way back when, in the, when the men wore the fedora hats and the big heavy wool coats going through Surrey. There's a lot of family memories there, and Arrow Lumberyard, all those people that were there. So, and I did pick up on that picture. I have it open right here. And another one I have on the next page is a gentleman named John Ossington, who used to be an employee of yours, used to sit in the peanut gallery here in council. So it's great to see you guys here, you know, and on behalf of your family and my family, who actually used your products. So
thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Schaefer.
112.
Go ahead.
One minor add. Cloverdale's commitment to charity over the last 30 years has been to the health care and to education. We have scholarships now almost in every college that I'm aware of from Manitoba West, and multiple scholarships, like Kwantlen has three, Victoria University, North Island, East Valley, Edmonton, Calgary, Nate, St. And also healthcare. We donated the Surrey Hospital run. Our staff would send employees to run, raise money. The company would match dollar for dollar. We donated $80,000 to the Surrey Hospital. 2 years ago, the company and the Vogel family donated $30,000 to the Patterson Clinic. And to the previous speakers, we have a program of free paint for nonprofit societies to do buildings, and it's in conjunction with product care. It's recycled, 100% recycled paint in 5 gallon pails, and if they're a legitimate nonprofit and it's not for resale, we will give them the paint. That's out of Dave Chalk, our branch man in Surrey, can arrange that. So I just thought that charity piece would be helpful too.
Thank you, Wink. I appreciate it very much. And I think, as Councillor Schaefer said and you talked about, when you go through here, I see pictures of former Mayor Duckworth and a number of people that were involved in various stages of development and evolution of your company. So it is a great book. I'll look forward to reading all of it. And there's a lot of history here for sure. So thank you very much.
I just talked to Bob Duckworth today, and he's getting a book next week.
Cool. And if I leave this with Darren, will both of you sign it for me before you leave? Whoops, don't trip, Darren. I would love to have your autograph in it as well. So thank you very much for your presentation. Maybe you're going to have to sign more than one. Why don't all members of council, if you want it signed, just give it to Darren, then he'll make sure it gets signed. And thank you, and I'll let you just go off to the side there, and if you don't mind, we're going to get into the rest of the agenda. The next item on the agenda is the Advisory Planning Commission meeting minutes, and Councillor Schaefer, seeing that Councillor Arnold is not here, is there anything other than what's on the agenda later on this evening?
No, just the rezoning application.
Okay. Are there any questions on the minutes? Seeing none, we'll move on from there then, and we'll go right into the Mayor's report. And the first items are the next regular council meeting will be on Monday, May the 6th, and that's the televised meeting, and the next one after that will be on Monday, May the 13th. And then moving from there, Councillor Martin, anything that you have from Metro Vancouver?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, I'd just like to report that if anybody's interested, There's 21 days, 11 hours, 26 minutes, and 6 seconds left till the provincial election. And I know this because Metro Vancouver has a site up called Local Government Matters. And what they have done is they posed questions to all the parties, and the questions and answers are available on this website if anybody is interested in it, localgovernmentmatters.ca. We've only got answers from one party so far, but we will keep after the other parties. And other than that, the border brief is attached, which is quite self-explanatory, unless there's any questions, which there will be, I know.
Councillor Hall.
I know you like to get these questions.
Sitting at the Council of Councils meeting, I had the fortune of sitting at a table with one of the other board members of the Metro Parks. And a discussion started about the raceway proposal in Campbell Valley. And I was wondering, here's the question. I gather that Metro has moved forward a study in reaction to some interest expressed by the proponents of the Historical Racing Society. And I was wondering if there was any flesh to that that the public might be aware of public consultation, whether it would just be of the township, whether it would include the city, would it be all areas that have some interest in GVRD Park?
Councillor Martin?
Well, given that it's a Metro Vancouver park, all residents of Metro Vancouver are affected, so it would be all of Metro Vancouver. The motion that was passed at the park committee was for the staff to look at the process and the feasibility of reopening the track. That report is supposed to come back on May the 16th. A concern that I have is that I don't think they can find out what the feasibility is within a month, certainly the process, but there is a consultation process in place with Metro Vancouver should it go any further than what it has already.
Thank you. Any other questions for Councillor Martin? Seeing none, library happenings, Councillor Schaefer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Monthly art critiques, Monday, April 29th from 7 till 9 p.m. It's, are you developing your talents as an artist? And come here to the library. Teen Writers Group on Monday, April 29th from 7:30 till 8:45. This group is for homeschoolers age 13 to 18. And then the last one I have is Travel Smart for Seniors, Saturday, May 4th from 2 till 3:30. And they'll have a representative from TransLink to learn about transit safety and accessibility. And the library phone number here is 514-2855. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Schaefer. Moving, there are no administrative reports this evening, and we'll move right into bylaws. The first bylaw is I need a motion for final reading of a bylaw to amend City of Langley Zoning Bylaw 1996, number 2100, to rezone the property located at 20299 Industrial Avenue to C1 Downtown Commercial Zone. Would someone like to move that, please? Moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor James. All of those in favor? Opposed, if any? The motion is carried. And now, in consideration of that, I need a motion that development permit application DP 0412 to accommodate a 15-story mixed-use high-rise development comprising of 29 multifamily residential units and 6,624 square meters or 71,300 square feet of commercial floor space located at 20299 Industrial Avenue be approved. Moved by Councillor James, seconded by Councillor Martin. All those in favor? It opposed? It is carried. Are you opposed, Councillor Schaefer? Councillor Schaefer is opposed, and the motion carries. Moving on from there, we'll move into bylaw 2906, first, second, and reading of a bylaw to amend City of Langley Zoning Bylaw 1996, number 2100, to add a new comprehensive development zone, CD35, and to rezone the property located at 5331, 5341, and 5369, 201st Street, 5332, and 5342, 208 Street, and 20040 and 20044 53B Avenue to the new zone. I need a mover. Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor James. Comments or questions? Seeing none, all of those in favor? Opposed? Councillor Schaefer is opposed. The motion is carried. Next one is Bylaw 2907, third and final reading of a bylaw to amend City of Langley Zoning Bylaw 1996, number 2100, medicinal marijuana. And Mr. Minchuk, you're going to make a short presentation? No? Okay. I need a mover. Moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor James. All of those in favor? Councillor Hall?
Third.
It's third and final. We're doing both at the same time. Yes?
Yeah. Okay, so I continue to be opposed to this, the genesis of this bylaw in the first place. Attempted to prohibit any number of things, prohibit meaning ban. The original genesis of the bylaw suggested that the city should ban auctions and arcades and any number of other things, and quite frankly, I think that government at any level should resist the idea that a ban as a measure of being the morality police is less useful than perhaps restrictive zoning, which could have been adopted in this case, as I have argued previously. We talked a lot about education with the gambling people that were here. I have attempted as best I could to educate both the public and council to the other alternatives. I have recently sent out to them a notice of what Squamish has contemplated in terms of both security and indoor restrictive industrial use. I believe once again that we are moving in the wrong direction here, and we leave ourselves open to legal contention. So I may well be the lone wolf against this, but certainly I believe that other municipalities are exerting a greater sense. I find it hard to believe that the people on this council that suggest that they are liberal can consider themselves more right-wing than a federal government that has actually addressed the problem and has taken measures to correct it. Thank you.
Any other comments? Seeing none, all of those in favor? Opposed? Councillor Hall is opposed, and thank you. The motion passes. Moving from there, we're moving into Bylaw 2909, third reading of a bylaw to amend the City of Langley zoning bylaw to add a new comprehensive development zone to rezone the property located at 20510 Langley Bypass. That was the subject of the public hearing this evening. And do I have a mover? Moved by Councillor James, seconded by Councillor Martin. No, sorry. No. Councillor Martin, second. Questions and comments? Councillor Martin and then Councillor Hall. Okay, Councillor Hall, you can proceed.
I do recognize that a transportation study was done on this project, but there have been some concerns raised about internal circulation of traffic. Through the mayor, I'd like to ask staff what control the city has over traffic circulation on site. There has been some suggestion that there be designated drop-off zones or speed bumps or some way to control that flow for the safety of the children that are there.
Mr. Chung?
Your Worship, to Council Hall, given that the traffic circulation issue raised by the next-door neighbors within private property, we have brought this to the attention of the applicants, and I believe that they're in a position to address this issue. and I will ask them to address this issue.
If you could come forward to the microphone, and whoever is going to address it, identify yourself, please. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Colin Murray, Vice President with BUK Investments, the owner of the property that CIFA are hoping to occupy. I believe the concern that was raised was on the neighboring property, so I cannot comment about what the landlords of that property would be doing. I can tell you at the property that we're discussing this evening, BUK has already recently resurfaced the entire parking lot at the property. We've installed some landscaping curbing to further slow and direct the traffic throughout the property. There are three buildings on the property, and we are going to be installing speed bumps at both of the major entrances as the final step of our parking lot improvements.
Thank you. Councillor Hall, does that answer?
Supplementary, in terms of management of this, a challenge for every school, and in effect this is a school, a daycare school, the challenge is always that parents are in a rush to drop off their children and leave. And certainly Stafford is a prime example of where people drop their kids off across the street and they dart across. Now, nobody in their right mind is going to drop their child in the suicide lane or across the street on the bypass. But at the front of the property, rather than going all the way to the back of the property where the school is, it's likely that a number of children are going to be dropped off. So from a management perspective of supervision of the school, what kind of personnel supervision will there be for the children that are dropped off?
Thank you. Susan Gaspar, Franchise Director with CIFA. The parents are required to drop off their children, so go and park their car and take their children inside. We have a secure fob system that they use to get into the school, and they walk their children to the classroom that they're in. They sign their children in. Licensing regulates that the children be signed in and out so we know who's on the premises just in case there's an emergency that happens. And they talk to the teacher, drop off their children for the day, and leave again. And it's the same procedure when they pick up. So there's no dropping the children out front or even at the front reception. They're walked to the classroom, signed in, signed out.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Councillor Martin.
Thank you. Well, I had the same concerns about the front and the traffic. And certainly the letter that we received from the tenants that are nearby suggesting that speed bumps be put in. So you say that that's what you're going to do now, and hopefully that will help. And of course the other concern is the playground. And it appears to be well protected with the cement barriers and I guess the black netting or whatever you put up there. It doesn't show on our map where the Langley bypass is. So where is the playground going to be located in regards to the school? Out front or out to the side?
I'm Brenda Ip. So the playground is actually at the back of the building, so you cannot see the playground when you're driving on Langley Bypass.
You won't see it?
You won't see it. It's behind the building. So the only access point into the playground is through the school.
Right.
And then, of course, it's also, electronically controlled, the doors, so that, you know, people can just go in and out. They have to be supervised, you know, kids.
Visions of a child getting out of there. Now, the other thing that I asked earlier was about the surface of the playground. And you said the rubber mats or wood chips. I would hope it's not wood chips in that area, certainly rubber mats, and there has to be something there for those kids.
So rubberized matting generally takes place in and around any structure where the children would climb. And in other areas, there's engineered wood chips. So they're not regular wood chips. They're specifically engineered for child care settings so that they don't disintegrate in the rain and such. And it's another option because sometimes the rubber matting can get a little bit slippery in the rain. So there's that option to put in and around outside the structural area as well on paths where the children would ride their bikes and such.
Okay, so if you're putting these manufactured, whatever you say, wood chips in there, how do they stay in place? I mean, if a kid goes skidding across and there's a blank, then you're left with open blacktop. So I'm not familiar.
There's the rubberized would go down, and then these would go on top, and there's quite a barrier between that. And there's the rubberized all the way through. So this goes on top just in areas where the rubberized might get a little wet and a little bit slippery so that they're not going to be slipping and sliding.
So you say they're about this deep.
Yeah, it's quite deep.
How do you walk on it? How do you play on it? I guess I need grandchildren to play out of it.
Yeah,
I don't know if my son's listening or not.
A lot of playgrounds, they're using that material now underneath the structures. So I don't know how to answer that question. Sorry.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Thank you very much.
I think I've seen them, and they actually provide a great amount of cushion.
Yes.
So if someone does fall off one of the structures, it provides a lot of cushion that even the rubberized mat doesn't, but the mat goes underneath these as well, right?
Yeah, and I haven't seen a lot of displacement, frankly.
Okay.
But I'm not familiar with the engineering of that. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other questions? Councillor Schaefer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yes, the Wicker Tree, which is a business next to this business, they have quite a few concerns on the traffic coming and going out of there. And another business there, the Revolution Gym, is at the back of the building, and the traffic in and out of the parking lot area is very fast, especially between 3 and 7. As through the mayor to the CAO, is our city comfortable with having this in an area like that?
Your Worship, Mr. through Councillor Schaefer, I believe the applicants had addressed that issues related to the traffic concerns. They're proposing to have resurfaced the parking lot. They have provided landscape curbing, and they will be installing speed bumps at the entrances.
Okay. I'll take them at their word then. Thank you.
I think the staff recommendation is to approve the application. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, all of those in favor? Opposed? The motion is carried. Thank you. Now I'd like to move into bylaw number 2911, first and second reading of a bylaw to amend the financial plan for 2013 to 2017. And I believe, Mr. Light, you are going to be making a presentation.
Yes, Mayor Fassbender, members of council. Tonight's amendment is to our 2013 to 2017 capital improvement plan. There are 8 items on this amendment. They total $672,000. $45,000 of that is already in our budget, but it's a reallocation of a sidewalk for one of the projects. Casino proceeds are allocated to $367,000. Grants are $18,000. The enterprise fund is $13,000. Machinery replacement is $60,000. And there is a community amenity fund allocation of $169,000. Of the 8 projects that are listed here, McBurney Lane is certainly the largest one. McBurney Lane project in our original budget had a total of $771,500, and when we tendered the project, the base price was $818,000, so there was a $191,000 increase in that budget. Staff have looked at that budget and had some items that they requested to continue to include in the project, and we're looking for an additional $134,000, $89,000 of that from casino proceeds, and $45,000 from a reallocation of the bench project in the downtown towards McBurney Lane. Second project is the surveillance system at McBurney Lane. There's a $31,000 request for a video surveillance system at the lane for public safety purposes. The third project is relating to Fraser Highway, the property purchases that we did on Fraser Highway. We have now had the opportunity to demolish the building and determine that there is some additional soil remediation required on that site, and we're requiring $160,000 to do that soil remediation.
Funded. Mr. Chung?
If I could add to Mr. Light's comments about the Fraser Highway property, what we have found, and this was found actually after the demolitions of the buildings on site, we found an old 4-inch storm sewer pipe underneath, directly underneath the building. So we weren't aware of this pipe. And this pipe contains some hydrocarbon products in it. And consequently, based on the assessment by the environmental consultants, we are required to remove this 4-inch pipe that contains hydrocarbons in the soils around the pipe. And this pipe runs lengthwise throughout the entire length of the building towards Fraser Highway. So it's quite a length. And consequently, the estimated cost to remove this pipe and the material surrounding the pipe is about $160,000.
Thank you. Mr. Light?
The fourth project is relating to a sanitary sewer realignment from under the CP rail tracks. And due to that realignment, there's an increase requested of $80,000, and that's funded through the casino proceeds.
Again, if I could add on to Mr. Light's comment, what happened was that as part of the sewer installation work, we require a right-of-way from the property owners of the subject site. Initially, we thought we were able to do an open-cut construction and build the sewer main around a sign, which has a large foundation. We were aware of the foundation, but once we start excavating, it was discovered that the foundation was actually larger than we thought it would be. We went back to the line owner to secure additional right-of-way so that we can have adequate rooms to go around this foundation for the sign. Unfortunately, the property owners was unwilling to do so. So the only way for us to complete the sewer main project is to do a unidirectional drilling of the sewer main underneath the foundation. And consequently, it is additional cost, about $80,000, to change our methodology from open cut to unidirectional drilling to allow us to complete this sewer main project.
Thank you.
The fifth project, we're going to refer to Mr. Minchuk, who will give a presentation on the fifth project.
Mr. Minchuk.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening again. I'm delighted to provide you with a brief overview of our wayfinding strategy. Langley City Council may be aware that the City of Langley wayfinding strategy originated from the 2010 Downtown Master Plan, specifically our public realm plan, where the public feedback indicated that many people struggle to navigate or find their way into and within the City of Langley. Wayfinding is a term used to describe how we process information within our environment to decide how to get from one place to another. Many cities have adopted wayfinding strategies and found that improving the legibility of a city helps support business, tourism, sustainable transportation, and creating a sense of place, which is the essence of our downtown master plan. In 2011, Langley City Council endorsed our wayfinding strategy following a comprehensive public process involving community stakeholders, including Cascades Casino, Downtown Langley Business Association, Chamber of Commerce and Tourism Langley. This evening, I'm just going to provide a brief overview of the wayfinding strategy progress that was completed in 2012 that has provided us with this opportunity that we are proposing in 2013. As a building block for future wayfinding projects, we have completed new mapping designed to improve legibility. The maps were created in the information database and reflect a systematic review of wayfinding criteria. The mapping is entirely digital and is integrated into the city's geographic information system and is easily updated. As an initial output, we have created a folder, a two-sided map, that has been circulated to council. Also worth highlighting as part of our wayfinding program, starting last year, we identified projects worthy of construction signage. Staff work with the graphic design consultant to design our vision in action construction signs, and to that end, developers were encouraged to install these signs at prominent construction sites throughout the city following adoption of the zoning bylaw that included projects including at the Collection, the Varsity development on Fraser Highway, and just around the corner, since we approved the adoption at this evening's council meeting, Charleston Place. This illustration also illustrates the 2012 progress, providing an overview of the wayfinding signage specifications that were developed last year in consultation with our wayfinding consultant. We also produced a mock-up to give a better impression for the scale and appearance for council's consideration. These specifications developed last year were also necessary for cost estimate and for procurement purposes. Which brings us up to today in 2013. What we're proposing this evening is to implement the Explore Downtown signage program recommended in the wayfinding strategy adopted by council. The program consists of three monolith signs, three minolith signs, six blade directional signs, and a three car park poster sign. What we feel is this enhanced signage will enhance visitors and shoppers' awareness of the city of Langley and will provide a valuable public amenity in the downtown streetscape. Also provides an opportunity for the city to further assert its branding and economic development program. This illustrates where the signs are being proposed to be installed, strategically located within the downtown core. And again, this illustrates the wayfinding signage locations using the symbolism of the different signage typologies. Which brings us to the reason why this subject is brought to Council's attention this evening. The cost of the proposed funding. The estimated cost for the implementation of the Exploring Downtown Wayfinding Signage Program is $236,000. Reflected in this year's financial plan currently is proposed a three-year program consisting of $67,000 to be allocated in the 2013, 2014, and 2015 financial plans, respectively. But rather than phasing the project over 3 years, using the budget, the budgeted funding noted, we are proposing to council the opportunity to implement the entire project for completion in 2013 by utilizing a portion of the community amenity reserve account. To do this, we would continue to use the $67,000 reflected in the 2013 capital financial plan, plus need to allocate a further $169,060 from the community amenity reserve account. We believe this approach offers three important advantages over phasing over a three-year period. Firstly, the main advantage would be cost effectiveness. Although we have not tendered nor procured this project to date, we feel pretty comfortable in stating that the cost of implementing over a three-year period will be higher than doing so all at once. Secondly, we think that there will be little value in implementing this piecemeal, as downtown patrons will become expecting a completed system for information that will be confusing if installed over several years. Finally, implementation in 2013 ensures that the momentum from the wayfinding strategy will further capitalize on the downtown master plan public realm implementation, including some of the exciting projects in store for the downtown core, including McBurney Lane and the new ornamental street lighting.
Thank you. Mr. Light.
Thank you. The sixth project relates to a, the city's been approached by the Langley Lions Club, and they're offering to contribute towards the installation of a portable AEDs in five of the city's facilities. In the original bylaw that we've had in your agenda package, we had showed that as $10,000. We've clarified that with the Lions, and they're willing to install the actual AEDs, but not the cabinet and the rest of it that goes with it. So it is still a $10,000 project, but they're contributing $3,000, and the city would therefore require to contribute $7,000. I've put on table the difference of the casino proceeds adding $7,000 and reducing $7,000 from the grant coming from the Langley Lions. The seventh project is the electrical vehicle charging station. As Council is aware, we've received a $15,000 grant from Fraser Basin to install that facility at our op center as well as here at City Hall. Council's already approved $13,000 from the Enterprise Fund, but we need to put it into our budget to allocate the funding from the grant portion, so the total project is $28,000. And the eighth project is the request to purchase two electric vehicles to replace two 12-year-old vehicles from our fleet here at the city, and the purchase price of those two vehicles total $60,000. That would be coming from the machinery replacement reserve.
Thank you. So in terms of moving forward, I need a motion for first and second reading of this bylaw. Moved by Councillor Mountain, seconded by Councillor James. And we're going to first ask for a motion now to go, excuse me, Carolyn? Oh, yeah, and then we can get into debate. But you have a question of clarification on that?
Actually, I do.
Okay, please.
I guess under number six, it says that the Langley Lions would like to contribute $10,000 to install. So you're saying they're only giving us $3,000.
Mr. Chung.
Council Martin, through the Mayor Fassman there. Based on our discussion with the Lions within the last couple of days, we clarified with the Lions that they're willing to contribute for that capital cost to purchase the defibrillator itself, but the casing, the training, and the extra batteries are not something that they're willing to fund at this point. So that costs approximately $7,000, and so that's why we're amending the schedule to reflect that the Lions will be contributing $3,000, and the city will be responsible for the $7,000 to make up the $10,000 cost to purchase five AEDs at our facility.
So we have to have the $10,000 in there. It's not $7,000.
That's correct.
Okay. I guess I don't know if it's appropriate this time, so I'll look for your direction here.
What I'd like to do is to open it, go into our committee of the whole to provide opportunity for the
okay.
public to comment.
All right.
Then we'll come back for third reading. So I need to ask for the motion for first and second reading. We can have discussion. So, Councillor Hall.
Yeah. Point of clarification. So why would I participate in a vote at this point if we don't have discussion at first and second?
You can have.
So we can,
I just said we can have discussion and questions at this point.
Okay. I would like to propose that item 5, the wayfinding signage, be removed at this point and brought back for first and second reading at the next meeting. In that we only recently received the wayfinding signage information this week. I find it inappropriate that we would have first, second, and third reading all at one meeting, particularly on this item. So while I recognize that the financial plan amendment was advertised to the public, they had little or no information on this particular item. So what that suggests is that the public has opportunity to speak about something that they had no information on. So it really means that the exercise of having this committee, the whole opportunity, is really a sham.
Is there a seconder for that motion?
There isn't a motion yet. So you're moving that it be removed?
Well, I'll make that motion then, and yep. If I could get a seconder to move that okay. portion.
Seconded by Councillor Schaefer.
No, I don't need to speak to it.
Nope, you just did. Thank you. Councillor Schaefer.
Thank you. Yes, I'd like to speak to it. The funding on that is actually coming out of the
Community Amenity Fund, Public Art Fund, and a chunk, the largest chunk, it will disappear, leaving only $7,000 left. And I do not disagree that some of the funding should come from this fund for the wayfinding signage, but not almost the entire fund. And having just had the information on what the signs look like and the costing, I would agree with my colleague that a full council should discuss this. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Seeing none, all of those in favor of the amendment to remove that item from the plan as presented, that is item 5. All of those in favor of removal, Councillor Schaefer, Councillor Hall, those opposed, Councillor James, Councillor Martin, and Mayor Fassbender, the amendment dies. So now I need a motion to go into Committee of the Whole. Moved. Seconded. Seconded by Councillor Martin. All of those in favor. It is carried. Moving into Committee of the Whole, are there any members of the public who wish to comment on the financial plan?
On a point of order, Mr. Mayor?
Yes, please.
You accepted those in favor of going into Committee of the Whole, but you did not ask if there were any opposed.
Oh, I'm sorry, Councillor Hall, you didn't indicate those opposed. Councillor Hall is opposed. So noted. Thank you. Now going back, are there any members of the public who wish to speak to the proposed amendment to the financial plan? And I don't see anyone stepping forward. So a motion to rise and report. Councillor James, Councillor Martin, all of those in favor. Opposed, if any. Councillor Hall's opposed to rising and reporting. And Councillor Schaefer, you are as well. Councillor Schaefer and Councillor Hall are opposed. The motion carries. We have risen and reported. And now I'm going to ask for a motion for third reading of a bylaw to amend the financial plan for 2013 to 2017. Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor James. Questions or comments? Councillor Martin first and then Councillor Hall.
Thank you. Okay. I think it's very, very commendable that the Langley Lines is going to contribute the $3,000, but I guess that, and you're saying the costs for everything, the cases, the training, and everything like that is $7,000, and do we know about the legal, the liability, and stuff like that yet in regards to operating these?
Mr. Chung? Council Martin, through Mayor Fassbender, our staff are still working on that, on those issues, and we'll be bringing all those together by the time we actually have the defibrillator in place.
By the time you have it in place?
Well, we will have all those policy and liability issues addressed, you know, by the time we actually take possession of the AEDs and that put it out onto the facility.
Well, I guess my concern would be is what cost could we incur because of that information, and if we've already got them in place, it's a little late then. I mean, and that's been my concern all along. I'm certainly not against having these AEDs, but you mentioned the last time we discussed this about the liability and the training and stuff like that. So until we purchase them, or I would not like to purchase them until we have the full information package. We're always talking about the, we don't get enough information to the public. I want this information because the public is going to be affected here by people applying the AEDs to them should they need it.
Yeah. Councilor Martin, through Mayor Fassbender, we can certainly, delay the purchase of the AEDs until we have those policy and all the cost implications in place first and bring it to Council's attention.
And that's okay with the rest? I mean, I think it's just
that. I think it's a fair question to ask staff for a full report before they're implemented. It doesn't affect the allocation at the moment, and if there is another element to it, then we can do that. I just want to clarify in my own mind, did I call the question on first and second reading? I did on the amendment, but I'm not sure I did on first and second. And Carolyn, you seem to think there's a question. So I'm going to call the question on first and second reading just to be sure. All of those in favor of first and second reading, Councillor James, Councillor Martin, Mayor Fassbender, those opposed, Councillor Hall and Councillor Schaefer, the motion is carried. So we indeed did make sure that we did vote on that. Thank you very much. Now, going back to third reading, again, the question is, so Councillor Martin, you've asked staff to ensure before we purchase anything, we have a full report on all of the issues related and liability concerns and so
on. That's right.
I don't see that as an issue at all.
You don't need a motion.
Mr. Chung, I don't think
that should not be an issue.
Staff will take direction. That'll be fine.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other? Councillor Hall.
I believe that would take a motion. In it, you've packaged many things here. This is a withdrawal from the actual amendment proposal. So if you're going to do that, and I frankly don't think that you should be doing that, I've argued all along that this is a time concern here. We need to have these things in place for this season, and I don't know what kind of timetable staff would set. But that aside, if you're going to withdraw something from this financial amendment until a later date, then
Councillor Hall, we're not withdrawing it. We're asking for more information before the amendment is applied. So we are not withdrawing anything from the financial plan amendment. So moving on, Councillor Schaefer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In getting more information, I think the public should be aware of how much the wayfinding signage is going to be costing. It's my understanding one of the stick signs with the fingers pointing out is about $9,000, give or take. So, I'm not against the wayfinding signage, as I said earlier. I just disagree on where the funding is coming from. I think it comes under the context of business, not under the context of art. And over the years, we have asked the development industry to put money into the fund for art fund, and yes, some signage, but not to the degree of leaving $7,000 left in here after putting $80,000 into McBurney. So we're putting $80,000 and $167,000 away. So I think the public should be aware of what the signage is going to cost.
Thank you, Councillor Schaefer. Councillor Hall.
The difficulty with packaging eight different items together like this is that one might support many of them but be opposed to a few. And in keeping with that, in all conscience, I would have to vote against the whole package. So that leaves the wrong impression. So certainly I support the AED proposal. Certainly I support some of these. Now I do have a problem with both the McBurney Lane project and the wayfinding. I think I've argued pretty consistently that the McBurney Lane project had an original budget, and it was quite small actually, because it was as a result of some vandalism. We've had two different sections of McBurney Lane over the years, estimated cost and design, and that's just kept growing and growing and growing. And now we've cut back on the project, but we're still simply replacing one set of bricks with another. So I'm not comfortable with the McBurney revitalization. I'm more uncomfortable with the wayfinding and the manner in which we're dealing with it. Ordinarily on capital projects, when we do the original capital budget, we have a number of priorities and we decide how we're going to allocate that. But now we have an amendment with nothing beside it that suggests what else we could be spending the money on. So if we restricted it like we had originally planned to $67,000 per year, we made some conscious decision to, yes, provide some signage, but not to spend this whack of cash that we have proposed here. It's $236,000 $1,000. A stick sign with a few fingers out of it costing $9,000. So I question the value in the signs, the number of signs that we have to provide. I question whether in the year 2013 that we need this kind of technology when we're now Wi-Fi wired. People have iPhones. They have the ability to Google. The city's only 4 square miles, and here we're putting up signs. The one consistent argument that I heard going into this last term, going door to door, was that people in this community thought that the $600,000 proposals for a wayfinding strategy was way out of whack. And I think that we should be listening to those constituents now and not trying to slide this through. So I'll be voting against the entire package, even though I approve of many of the items.
Thank you. Councillor Schaefer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Like my colleague, I have to vote against the entire package, even though I'm only against one. I'm only against one of them. You know, as different to my colleague, I'm in favor of number six and number one, but I am against number five. So, having them bundled up like this, I have no alternative but to vote against the entire package.
Well, an amendment is still possible. We only dealt with one item on an amendment. If someone wants to move another one, that is up to them. Councillor Schaefer.
If I may, I'd like to make an amendment to vote on them separately from 1 to 8.
So you want to deal with each item separately? Please. That is possible to do, absolutely. Is there a seconder? Councillor Hall. I think the motion is clear. Those in favor of the motion to vote on each item separately, indicate. Those in favor, Councillor Hall, Councillor Schaefer. Those opposed, Councillor James, Councillor Martin, and Mayor Fassbender. The amendment is defeated. We're back to the main motion. So I'm going to call the question on the motion. And all of those in favor, Councillor James, Councillor Martin, Mayor Fassbender, those opposed, Councillor Hall, and Councillor Schaefer, the motion passes. Thank you. Moving on, we're moving to bylaw 2911. 2911. No, I just did that, didn't I? Sorry. I'll be all right. Now, bylaw 2912, final reading of a bylaw to levy property value taxes for municipal purposes for 2013. A mover. Second, moved by Councillor Hall, seconded by Councillor Schaefer. All of those in favor, opposed. The motion is carried. There are no motions or notices of motion. There is correspondence which we received from the village of Belcarra. And within that, there is a request that has come to us along with other municipal governments within the Metro Vancouver area to support a preservation for future generations of Admiralty Point federal lands. And would someone like to move that we send a letter of support? Councillor Martin moved, seconded by Councillor Schaefer. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, all of those in favor, opposed if any, the motion is carried. Is there any unfinished business? New business, Councillor James.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I've got a couple of things, actually. First of all, Wednesday is our annual Local Government Awareness Day, and once again, City Hall and the yard around will be transformed, and in excess of 200 grade 5 students from the City of Langley Schools will have a great time. There's tours planned, there's goodie bags for them. We had a poster contest that the kids all participated in. I can't say who the winner is because they don't even know yet. But one lucky student from one of the schools won, and his entire class is going to be having lunch with you. And I just wanted to acknowledge McDonald's and Fortis BC. They were extremely generous sponsors again for, like I say, the goodie bag materials and each of the teachers get a $100 scholastic certificate for thanking them for participating. So I am very excited to have them come and inundate us again. I think it'll be a great time.
And I hear the weather's going to be good, yeah. So that'll be great.
And the second thing, if I may,
yes, please.
Just real quickly, I was recently in attendance at the BIABC, which is the provincial body of business improvement associations across the province, and I'm delighted to report that our Remembrance Day banner program was selected and won for partnerships and programs, and there was numerous entries from across the province, and it's generated a lot of excitement and a lot of emails to me from other communities asking how they can do the same thing in their community. So it was an awesome moment. Thank you.
And I'm assuming that the Legion is well aware of that, and Pacific Command as well, because their support is critical to the success of it. One other item I wanted to bring up under new business. We had a meeting earlier this evening in our working session where our fire chief and emergency coordinator gave us an update on the situation with the residents from the Elm building. And suffice to say, our city staff, both in terms of our building inspector, our fire department, is working with all of the various agencies and the Lions to try and get as many of the residents in as quickly as possible. We also did hear that there were some challenges because of the size and the nature and the number of people that were involved in this, and we did indicate that this council will be supportive of ensuring that those lessons will be communicated to the other government agencies who've been involved and need to be involved in a similar situation in the future. The other thing is I want to, on behalf of council, and I'm taking the liberty to speak on behalf of council, thank everybody who stepped up to the plate in the community, whether it was commercial organizations who provided blankets, to the Gateway of Hope who provided food at various stages throughout the process, to other people who came out and wanted to help, our emergency volunteer group who worked tirelessly and still are helping to assist. And we will continue to be updated on the schedule and the timing of that. And we will also bring at an open council meeting, a televised meeting, the people who really stepped up and for us to recognize them. Because when you see the amount of people, including the township fire department and others, that came forward and were supportive, I think it's critical for us to publicly thank them, and we will do that in a public forum to ensure that we do that adequately and with the amount of respect that we have for everybody who did that. So that will be coming up at a future televised meeting. Is there any other new business? Seeing none, I'll accept a motion for adjournment. Moved by Councillor James, seconded by Councillor Schaefer. All of those in favor? Anyone opposed? It is carried. Thank you.